So, a very warm welcome to the last session for today. Later on we come to the fun part, a lot of good stuff at the booths. So I hope you will enjoy also some relaxing drinks at the exhibition after my presentation. In this session I would like to cover the topic of CEF, which is a fascinating technology to build the future generation of storage. As we all know, the cloud is changing everything, so it's also changing storage in a sense that it's getting unpredictable what type of capacity will be needed when going in a cloud project. Yeah? Today we have a very stable data growth every year, but the cloud is changing everything. Yeah? If you are a cloud provider or you start to build your internal cloud, you never really know which type of workload will probably be brought on the storage system when and in what quantity. Now, if you take a normal storage architecture of today, typical scale-up RAID systems, they are very mature, they're very reliable, they have a certain scalability, but they have a shortcoming when they're coming to the cloud and the data are rising, and there's a kind of a divide, I call it the petabyte bit divide. Oh, please, there is some lots of free space in the front rows, I'm not spitting. But there are some shortcomings, yeah? So if you scale beyond the petabyte, a high-end storage system is very, very expensive. And it will probably have scalability limits in terms of capacity and performance. Another big issue is the RAID construction. RAID is a very efficient way to care for data redundancy, but today we have 4 terabyte disk. If a 4 terabyte disk fails, the rebuild time could be 1 day, 2 day. If it's a fully loaded system, even longer. Now imagine the future, 6 terabytes are coming, 8 will come, and 10 have been announced. So the probability that another disk will fail during the rebuild time of a disk is rising. So data loss gets much more probable than it used to be. Then, of course, data migration. Think about you have reached the petabyte divide or hundreds of terabytes and you have to move them after some years to a new storage system. That takes a pretty long time, is a little and a huge effort. And then, of course, cost per gigabyte. Yeah, we're all under cost pressure. There's nothing for free in IT anymore. Disk density, data center space. So it's about thinking about new generation of storage. In Fujitsu, we were, as a storage vendor, we had a project running now for 2 years and it's now finalized and the product is out. We were thinking, how could the future of storage look like? First, we made a requirement list, what is actually needed, so kind of a Christmas list, if I can wish something. First of all, in the cloud, I need modular scalability, not only from capacity, but also from performance. I need zero downtime. You cannot recover petabytes of data, or in the future, petabytes of data easily. Yeah? So it should always be running. It should be possible to refresh the technology. If you have tons of data, it should be capable of refreshing the hardware once it's end of life, but still keep the system going. This is why everybody is looking at software-defined storage, because it's separating the intelligence of the system from the hardware, and you can replace components, and the storage system can theoretically live forever, as long as the storage is available, software is available. Data management, yeah. If you're in storage, you know how hard it is to tune a system, and it will get worse when you have tons of data, so it should be somehow self-optimizing, so automating the service levels to the end users. It should have an efficient management to deal with this petabytes of data. And of course, it would be nice if the total cost for the capacity would go down and not go up. Then, today what's quite common is block device and file devices. But if you increase the number of files, today's file systems will be at its end. So we have already customers with billions of files, and traditional file systems support it anymore. So it's object is on the rise, object storage will be in the rise. And in order to avoid to have different storage silos again, like in the past, also in the present, such a system should cover object, file, and block support. Now, when evaluating what can be a future technology, 2 years ago we started to evaluate Ceph, whether it's a software which is also for larger implementations. And we were surprised how stable it is running in its core, what you can do. Theoretically, you can just put Ceph on a cluster of servers and build a very, very scalable storage system. It's really fascinating how this technology has evolved. And the good thing is it's 100% compatible with OpenStack. So if you're on a cloud project, Ceph is a good choice for storage software to implement it in the cloud environment. Now, when we were evaluating Ceph and we were thinking of a big installation, we immediately found out that it's a hard job. First of all, installing Ceph on a server is a very easy deal, and connecting servers is also not difficult. But think of failure situations. A node in this cluster fails. How fast must be the interconnect be between different storage nodes to recover the redundancy again? How do you maintain the whole stack? Yeah. So we did it also in our labs, had some old servers because we don't had to go for another investment round. So we had a mix of servers connected and it was performing like a big storage system. But maintaining it was awfully difficult because every new version of Ceph, every new patch of Ceph was influencing the drivers. So it didn't fit with one storage server system. It didn't fit together with a network component. So maintaining such a stack is extremely difficult. Yeah? So it's a kind of a research project internally. Then the maintenance part was really awful. Yeah? Of course, Ceph delivers a lot of management tools. I mean, but of course, you have other tools to manage the server, to manage the network, to manage the drivers, and so on. So it's instead of a normal storage, traditional storage system, you have typically one management console. And here now you end up with 10 or so, yeah, because it's a stack. Then, of course, if you look also on a commercial point of view, you have now different components from different sources. Yeah? The server from one vendor, the connectivity from another, the Ceph from whatever distribution you have chosen, and so on and so. So in a nutshell, you have to deal with 5-6 vendors for this storage stack. So it's also from a commercial point of view, managing the maintenance contract a difficult thing. And then, of course, it's a troubleshooting. In a normal, traditional RAID system, you can go to one vendor. If there's a glitch, say, please fix it, I have a maintenance contract. But if you build it of your own, then this storage system is existing only once in the world. Yeah? If you go to a traditional vendor, buy a normal storage system, this system will be 100 or 1,000 time out, and there is a standardized support. But here you have built your own storage system, and you are on your own to do the troubleshooting. And then the Ceph guys say, no, no, it's a networking problem. The networking guys say, no, it's a server problem. And somebody else says it's an operating system problem, and so on and so on. And this is not real fun when you deal with petabytes or terabytes of data. Yeah? So instead of doing this, we were thinking, what can we do as a vendor to make it easier? And this is why we said, why not delivering it out of the box? And this is what we recently released, and you can see also on the booth. After the session is a system we call Eternal CD10000. The C stands for cloud. And it brings everything together. The Ceph software, the compute hardware, the storage devices, the interconnect, and the maintenance. So it's one appliance which can scale to a huge extent, and you have one vendor you can go to in order to solve any problem. Yeah? So this is how it looked like. At the bottom, you see a cluster of servers, or we call it storage nodes. There are different flavors. Basic storage node for development purposes, capacity nodes with lower spinning disks to host a lot of capacity, and performance nodes which give a very high O and have SSD caches and so on and so forth. And they are connecting with a very fast interconnect, that's InfiniBand. I'll tell you later why. And to the front end, it's standard Ethernet, 10 gigabyte Ethernet. The brain of it is Ceph. We have chosen the Inktank and now Red Hat distribution. And we have added a management layer on top, which gives you one single point of control of every component in the hardware and every component in Ceph. So you have only one management system to run the whole construction. And this is also important, otherwise you have to deal with five or more management tools. Then of course we are contributing to the Ceph community. We found several glitches for high performance environments where we need a fast storage, so we are already contributing to the core development in order to fix some glitches. At the beginning we will support object level access, but also block level access, so you can use it also as a standard storage system, even if you don't are in a cloud project. File will be released at a later point of view. This is something on the roadmap in 2015, because the Ceph-related file system is not the brightest one on the market. This will be coming later. And wrapped around is a complete management service. So whenever you take an Eternal CD 10,000, you call one vendor whenever there's a glitch in the core, in the Ceph, in the interconnect. So it's like dealing with a normal storage vendor. Now, what is actually the advantages of such a system? By just adding nodes, you can scale more or less endlessly. I show you a little bit later how far it goes. The construction is made in a way that there is no reason to have any downtime, be it in a failure situation or in a maintenance situation. It can be refreshed online, so you can pull in new technology without driving the system down, so it's more or less immortal. It will support block, file, and object. And it is also cost optimized because it's built on standard components. And it's using standards, in this case Ceph, which is a perfect fit to OpenStack projects. Now let me go a little bit more in detail. It was double. One more up. So in the system, wait a minute, I have to go back. Okay, in the system, the Ceph algorithm is responsible to bring the data in a kind of a intelligent distribution to the different nodes and different disks. This is also a big advantage in a sense that a file, for instance, is highly distributed in terms of data blocks within the system. So there's lots of parallel reads and writes if you are using the system. So even with slower disk, it gets very, very fast. And it has a kind of a built-in high reliability. It's not a RAID system anymore. So the redundancy is you define in one volume, I have two replicas. This means every data block is there physically two times. If you see I have higher service level and I'm more careful, then you can decide to have three replicas, four, five. If you say, I want to save money, there is something called erasure code, then you have a 1.3 relationship, which is make it very efficient. So some people already said, yeah, RAID is more efficient, so it's not too much spare capacity used. It's depending on your service level, and you can define it by volume. So you can give different service levels to the end users. So now in case a complete node fails, probably with lots of disk, this mechanism cares that the redundancy is done or rebuilt in some instances, yeah? Because many disks are now writing on many disks, so it goes very fast. And this is also why we have chosen InfiniBand as a backend infrastructure that a node failure can be recovered, or the redundancy can be recovered very quickly. Yeah? This was also a learning about 2 years of testing and developing. If you are not caring about the whole system architecture, then failure situations can be very harmful. Now, I say immortal system, okay, this is a very bold marketing statement, but in a traditional RAID system, there is a certain point in time, either the system is full and you have to buy a bigger system, or it's so old that you can't get any spare hardware anymore. Yeah? And then you typically have to do a data migration, and if it's a very big system, then it can take a very long time. What you can do here is just add a node, and once the system has detected the node, it redistributes data in an intelligent way, and you have more capacity. Now, if this hardware, what you are using, is no longer available, then you add the next generation of nodes. And the system keeps on running, and then after time, you can replace the older nodes with newer nodes, always online. So it's like an organism with some cells. Yeah? If some cells on your skin are dying, they are replaced by fresher, younger cells, and so you can keep the system alive as long as the software, in this case Ceph, is existing. Yeah? So probably Ceph will not exist forever. There will be in 10, 15 years some bright new inventions, but for the foreseeable time, you can create a very, very long lifetime of a system. So in fact, you don't have to migrate for a pretty long time. Now, block, file, and object access, I already mentioned. File coming a little bit later. It's on the roadmap in 2015. This is also important in order to avoid newer storage silos, because here you have a highly scalable system, so why not having every type of data on one system? And it's not a good idea to create new silos again. So. There may be also future formats of storage access, so block, file, and object is just the beginning. We expect there will be more variety in the future. For instance, a lot of this virtualization guy are constructing new types of storage access, like VMware is now shortly before releasing vVol, and such type of access methods. So there will be more specialized methodologies in the future, which can be built in such a system. Now, cost optimized. First of all, not automatically a software-defined storage system is cheaper than a conventional system, because as long as you are using enterprise-quality disks, the total cost of, or the total purchase price of a system is defined by the number of disks. Yeah? But on the other side, there are some things which will bring down the cost. First of all, such a system is based on standard x86 hardware, so it needs no special development. So the total cost can be, and the efficiency, the scale of efficiency is better, so the cost can go down. Then the open source software, open source software Ceph, is of course bringing the cost down. Especially in a sense that a lot of functions where you normally would pay extra in a classical RAID system for high availability, for thin provisioning, for kind of replication mechanisms, yeah, these are all extra costs, typically priced by volume. This is no longer necessary because it's part of the design, it's part of Ceph. Yeah? So it's one software with all inclusive. Ceph delivers also a lot of automation feature, how to rebuild the system, how to rebalance the system, how to replicate data. Yeah? This is also part of the initial cost, so there's no extra bringing costs down. So it's affecting more the total cost of storage. If you just would take the raw price per capacity, this would probably not make a much difference, but if you estimate the total cost of ownership, then it's a completely different picture. Then, of course, on a longer run, you have less migration costs because the system is just refreshed or expanded as you need it. So there are storage migration project is a costly thing, or at least costs a lot of effort if you do it alone. The long life cycle is also paying back, so less complete new investments are necessary. And of course, as we bring it as an end-to-end support, you save also support costs. You get it in one shot instead of having a diluted kind of a cost distribution by many vendors so delivering many services for many components. So what is actually then different instead of building a Ceph-based storage of your own? First of all, although it's basing on open source, it's a maintained storage system, yeah? So you don't have to care about it. So, and if you are on your own, then you probably will face a lot of troubleshooting. The end-to-end maintenance I already mentioned. Adding new functionality is also on our roadmap where Ceph has gaps. For instance, we will introduce VMware driver. We have embedded a lot of SMTP traps to have remote management. So this is all this extras a normal Ceph environment cannot deliver today. Then of course, integrated management of all components. This is also something you don't get it from the shelf. It's a performance optimized sizing. So we were testing a lot how to build a cluster environment and to standardize the cluster nodes in order to make them reliable and also very performant in daily operation. And then also very interesting, we are starting to add apps on top of the system, which can help you to provide intelligent data-related services. Let me give you an example, a real-life example of one of our customers. In Germany, there is currently a beta phase of a very interesting project that's from the German Stock Exchange. They have built a daughter company which now is using a trading platform for trading IT resources. If you go to this platform, and it's live, if you go to the internet link, you see what you can purchase, or let's better say rent for a certain time. You can rent CPUs, RAM, and disk capacity. And so a lot of, and the whole platform is based on OpenStack. And now they have already first customers consuming these resources. But of course, as this company does not provide resources itself, it's relying on partners who are delivering this compute and storage resources. So now put yourself in your shoes. You are now a service provider, which is here seller one, seller two. How much storage would you purchase? Yeah, you don't have any clue because you don't know how much users will enter this trading place and consume how much storage. So for a provider in such a market, it's extremely difficult. This is why a data center decided for this Eternus CD10000 system, because they start very small. They started with roughly 70 terabyte, which they are offering in this marketplace. But if this marketplace takes finally off, then they can scale more or less endlessly and they have no downtime. And so they can offer very good service levels at an interesting price to this marketplace. I said we will bring apps on top of the system. So currently we have added an application called iRods. iRods is an open source data management system which helps you to build large archives. So it's about data management and retrieval. We are thinking about adding sync and share software on top of it to build a kind of a Dropbox type of environment. So we are currently approaching a lot of ISVs and software vendors, trying to bring them into this ecosystem. I give you now an example, a real-life example from another customer. A university in Germany, that's in a small city called Mainz. They have a university of roughly 15,000 students and several hundred professors. They had distributed IT, so each department, chemistry, computer science, physics, they had their own IT and their own storage. And they said, no, we can't go on like this. We have to offer a central IT. And with this, they wanted to have a centralized storage. And they are obliged by law and by some regulations to keep all the data 10 years online, all the doctor theses, all the test data of experiments in the physics and the chemistry department. Yeah, and of course, 15,000 students in 10 years' time produce a lot of stuff. Yeah, so they had also the problem: how much capacity should we buy? Yeah, and should we buy a high-end system? We cannot afford it. We are a university. So typically universities are not rich. So they decided for an eternal CD10,000, saying we start small and we are adding more data after time. And they put iRods on top. The iRods software is for their library services and for the retrieval of tons of data. The next step is now that they want to implement a safe sync and share service for the university campus, and they want to differentiate which data can be publicly accessed and which not. And this is why they are now in the next project deploying a sync and share software on top of the system. Typical usage areas. So what a software-defined storage system of this type is good if you have big data amounts and if you have uncertain growth. If you are in the area of a couple of terabytes, then it can't be recommended, then it's the best system, you go for a standard RAID system, because a scale-out system needs a certain basic investment, because you have by design you need a couple of nodes that the system can really work. And if you have only few data volumes, then it doesn't make sense. So a sensible thing to start with is if you are in an area of 200 terabytes and more in production. Yeah, of course, for test reasons, they are typically smaller. Now, typical usage areas are OpenStack environments, because it's based on Ceph, so it's completely integrated from the scratch. If you are any type of service provider, being internal service provider or external service provider for the cloud, because then you have this uncertainty how much data you need tomorrow. Telecom businesses, we are currently talking to some of the telecoms who are now getting IT service providers offering sync and share or some data services on top of the typical telecom business. University and research organizations, I mentioned before, but also in the public sector. This is very interesting because the public sector has tons of files about the citizens, tax or police or whatever. So having tons of data online. Then when you deal with multimedia, because it's a highly distributed system, so there are only small data chunks on one disk and they are highly distributed, so the read mechanism is highly parallelized, writing mechanisms are highly parallelized, so ideally for streaming and writing media. Business analytics, in a sense, when you have to aggregate a lot of historical data and keep them online for analytical reasons. And we currently have also contact with a lot of financial institutions, not for replacing their core storage system. This seems to go on for a pretty long time with standard RAID systems, but the cloud projects of financial institutions, here we have some proof of concept. Now, in a nutshell, this is Ceph out of the box without the hassle of a lot of experimenting and having hassles in maintenance. So it provides more or less unlimited scalability. In its first release, it's covering 56 petabyte, so should be enough with more than 200 nodes. We haven't yet seen a case where somebody has so many data. Perhaps the NSA would be a good example, but not a customer of us. It has zero downtime by design. It can live forever, at least as long as Ceph exists. Unified in its completeness, cost optimized by building out standard, and we are working heavily together with Red Hat and InkTank, constantly improving the system. If you want more, know more about the system, you find us on the booth C4. This is in front of the auditorium part. Actually, as Fujitsu is a Japanese company, I want to highlight that today a magazine voted a Japanese whiskey brand for the best in the world, and we have it on our booth, so you can test it and perhaps also get some spirits about Ceph on the booth. Thank you for listening. If you have some questions, please shoot now. Thank you. Please. Excuse me? Yes, the control panel can do magic things. Yeah, you can say I build pools, I can distribute data to certain locations, and such type of things. So we can we have a demo on the booth, and you can see how it's done. Yeah. Whether we have control about the crash algorithm, yeah. So if there are no questions right now, there's the opportunity still today and tomorrow to visit us at the booth. Thank you for coming.